When you take Liza Minnelli, a multi-talented star of American stage and screen, and team her with the ultimate European entertainer Charles Aznavour, you get an unbeatable combination. This dynamic duo has been dazzling audiences since their premiere performance in Paris in 1991 with a month-long string of sold-out performances. Well, they're together again, stepping out and entertaining audiences across the U.S. Liza, there's a distinct message in your 1991 film, Stepping Out, that abusive and domineering men are out in the 90s and that sensitive men are in. And here you are, you're touring with one of the most sensitive and romantic men of the 20th century.
Yes, cool, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Massively cool.
There's also this wonderful line in Arthur which you have where you say there's so many girls and too few princes. If you look at your theatrical career, you've had an opportunity to tour with the great princes, Frank Sinatra, Sammy Davis Jr., now Charles.
But I knew Charles. Charles was the first one to ever make me feel like I had real talent and a real contribution to make. When I was 17 or 18, he saw me, I think before anybody else really did, because I was, you know, I hadn't done anything.
Yeah, everything was there anyway. I saw her on television. I don't know what it was, but I saw her on television before I met her, and everything was there.
But she had a wonderful vulnerability, didn't she?
Yes. She has something that everything goes fast with her. She goes from the laugh to the tears very easy, very fast, because she's in. Because she's not, it's not a trick. She feels it, she lives it. What is important on stage is to live the situation. It's not to recreate only the situation. We recreate, of course, but only also to live it.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I've thought of being a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray and step around the heart of it, New York, New York.
The first thing Charles did was translate a song for me. He took me to Paris, first of all. He said, listen, you have to come to the Olympia because people will enjoy what you're doing. They'll enjoy it more than they do in this country. And he was right, because...
No, for the start, it was fantastic, you know, absolutely unknown. She was the first billing, she was the only one. You were alone, no?
There was a whole bunch of, there were American dancers and there was everything. I was just at the top of the bill.
Yes, that's
it.
At the Olympia. And it was like this. The success was over a minute, not overnight.
And Liza, on the flip side of that, you were actually singing Charles songs back in the 70s when people like Fred Astaire and Shirley Bassey were making them famous, and you were always comfortable with his music, weren't you?
Oh, always. Yeah. Because they were songs for an actor or an actress.
Les courants toi et moi, les plaisirs démodés. Ton cœur contre mon cœur, malgré les rythmes fous, je veux sentir mon corps par ton corps épousé.
Both of you have this wonderful natural quality on stage, and I would think that it would put you in good stead for film work as well as theatrical productions. But I can't help but wonder if this may have come from the fact that both of you were child stars. Charles, of course, you started in Henry III at a very young age. Liza, you were touring with your mother when you were just literally out of the cradle. And I'm wondering if this similarity between the two of you has made you the successes that you are.
There have been two schools in the world. Even though we haven't been on those schools, but we know I get about. For me, it's Stanislavski. And in America, there was the way of acting very easy, and she has that. And it's important. The background is very important because we know, I guess we know each corner of this work. The acting, the singing, the dancing. The conducting, if we need it.
Yes.
And the lighting, you. I saw that. That from your father.
I know.
Charles, looking at your early life, you had the opportunity to collaborate with one of the great pianists and composers. Did that contribute to your concertizing style and your composing and ultimately lead to the success that you have today?
I don't know. You know, I know nothing. Everything happened by itself. I never wanted to be a star. I wanted to be on stage. Mm-hmm. And I didn't. Yes. I never wanted to be an international star. I wanted to sing somewhere. That was it, you know. So I don't know. Anything I can say, I'm going to lie. So I better don't say anything.
Charles, I find it hard to believe that there was actually a time when people were hard on you and the audience threw cans at you and were abusive.
Yes, but that's a great time because it built you. It gives you the strength and it gives you something else. It gives you sometimes you doubt of yourself and you say to yourself, maybe they are right, and you go into yourself and you learn and work more.
There is a time for spring and for sighing, a time to laugh, a time to be crying, a time for dreams and for sweet pretending, but then it seems that suddenly it's ending. This time there's no time to waste. We fail away as fast as the morning mist. This time let's not hesitate. So take my life, my love, my eagerness for this time there's no time to waste. We fail away as fast as the morning mist. This time let's not hesitate. So take my life, my love, my eagerness for time.
Tonight's a very special night for you both because you'll be performing here in Washington, D.C. and finishing this tour. But I was wondering, are you going to collaborate again in the future?
Oh, yes.
Every year, I hope. Yes. We have to do this at least once a year.
Start by admitting from cradle to tomb.
Thank you for joining us on National Arts. I hope you enjoyed meeting our award-winning cadre of friends. Until next time, remember, art was meant to be appreciated, so you be a part of it.